our country, we think about Independence Day. I think I said this earlier in our prayer time this morning that July 4th will be our 247th birthday, I believe, as a nation. So in 1776, and then 2026 will be 250 years for our country. Our country is young, really compared to a lot of nations, isn't it? No, it's a young country. But this week we celebrate that independence, that freedom. And our country was founded upon Christian principles and values. And there are some who seek to revise that, or they want to say, well, that ain't really the way our country developed. But that's the way it developed. I believe that truthfully, the pilgrims and the Puritans who came to this country established this country upon the Bible and the Scriptures, and it was because of their faith that were being impressed that they wanted to come and worship freely. So our country really was a Christian nation, but I believe that our nation is really no longer a Christian nation. I mean, really, it's a post-Christian nation. And even the Christian denomination, or Christian faith, I should say, is no longer the dominant religion in the world. I mean, there's other denominations or religions that are more popular than Christianity is today. So Christianity is on the decline, and the agenda of those who reject the Bible and who reject Christian values is really becoming more prominent. We're seeing an uprising of those who don't believe the Bible. I mean, that's antiquated. That stuff's outdated. We don't need the Bible anymore, they would say. And it's an agenda for them. They put their spin on the way that society and our culture works to say, well, we don't need that anymore. That's old. That religious stuff, we don't need that. And if they want to practice it, that's okay, but just let them do it on Sunday. And that should satisfy them. Well, that's not what we do as believers. And we're seeing cases that are coming against people in our country today. We're seeing people who want to stand on their faith. They want to practice what they believe, but there are many cases that are coming against Christian believers, and unfortunately, many of those cases are going against Christians. We're seeing that. They're being charged with crimes because they won't stand up for what they believe, but the world doesn't see it like they do. And so Christians should have the right, constitutionally, of freedom of religion, freedom of speech, and the practice of our faith, but it is under attack, I'm telling you folks. It's under attack. Our freedom as a nation is really at risk. Here's what Kai Feldblum, and I don't know how long ago this was, I just found this quote, but Kai Feldblum was the commissioner of the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, the EEOC. And they said this, they said, there can be a conflict between religious liberty and sexual liberty, but in almost all cases, the sexual liberty should win. That was the thought, that sexual liberty should win. Here's a real life case. This is the case of Baronelle Stutzman of Arlene's Flowers. Baronelle Stutzman had for decades been delighting the people of Richland, Washington, over in the corner of the state, of the nation, with her floral creations. Rob Ingersoll was her friend and was not just one of her best customers, but he really understood how much of herself she poured into these floral arrangements that she weaved so well. And Baronelle had put together all kinds of wonderful creations for the special events and occasions that were important to Rob. And so it nearly broke her heart the day he came in and asked her to come up with something original for the most important occasion of all, the one occasion that she could not, in good conscience, agree to. She couldn't help him celebrate that. You see, Rob said he was marrying another man. And Baronelle's Christian faith is grounded in Scripture that teaches marriage is the union between a man and a woman. And so she broke it to him as gently as she could. And he said, well, I understand. He even hugged her. He gave her, you know, a nice response. And so his partner did not. His partner did not. And so, in outrage, his partner, Rob's partner, went on Facebook and began to proclaim what had happened. And he drew attention for people, you know, who were like-minded. They pushed the same-sex, same-marriage on Americans, including... And what happened was the state attorney general, Bob Ferguson, found out about it. And Ferguson said, I'm going to make an example of Baronell. And so he filed a customer complaint lawsuit against her, charged her with illegally discriminating against Rob on the basis of sexual orientation. And it was an unusual course of action because Rob and his partner, they did not file any kind of, you know, complaint. Well, and they got their flowers. That wasn't a problem that they couldn't get flowers. So, and even the State Human Rights Commission, which would have been the agency charged with instigating such action against cases of those matters, they hadn't pursued a claim either. So it was just Ferguson. He made it a personal priority, not only in filing a lawsuit, but he denounced Baronell from political stops all over the state. And so in the months to come, following the lawsuit and a barrage of media coverage, Baronell's shop was deluged with phone calls and received all kinds of hate mail and people who really didn't know much about the case. They didn't know what happened between Baronell and Rob, and they denounced her decision, and they marked her face by saying, she's crazy. She's a weird woman for standing up for this. And there are many other cases like that, folks. Many other cases that I could cite. Well, God's people are under persecution, I believe, today. We're under attack, and we've got to stand up for our faith. I don't believe we can shrink. We can't be intimidated. We can't step back. Certainly, we have to obey the laws of the land. But as we've said, when the law of the land interferes with the law of God, we have to make a choice, do we not? And you have to decide who you're going to serve in those circumstances. Baronell decided, my Christian faith tells me that I can't support this same-sex marriage. And by her creating a flower arrangement, a special arrangement, he could have walked over, there's a shelf, and picked any arrangement off of the shelf that he might have wanted. And she would have gladly sold him that. But he wanted her to create and do something special for him, to celebrate this. And that would mean it would be against her conscience to do that. So we're seeing that God's people should respond to persecution through prayer. And we're going to turn to Acts 4, if you'll turn there with me. And we're going to see the same story we talked about last week with Peter and John having been detained by the Sanhedrin, the rulers and the counselors. And they called them in and said, you need to quit talking about this Jesus. And they said, well, we can't really do that. And they threatened them further and they sent them off. And so that's where the story picks up. We're going to see what did Peter and John do after this situation. And so in verse 23, if you have your scriptures, I hope you do, Acts 4, verse 23, says, when they had been released, that's Peter, that's John, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And so they told what had happened to them, what the rulers had done in threatening them. And they may have been gathering in this same upper room that they did back in chapter 1 when the Holy Spirit came to Pentecost. And so there was a spirit of confidence and trust among the church. They recognized that when one member suffered, all of them suffer. And that scripture I have on the screen, 1 Corinthians 12:26 says, if one member suffers, all the members suffer with him. So they recognize that Peter and John were suffering, that we're a part of that. We're a part of the church. We're part of the body of Christ. And it should be the same with us when there's an issue among the people of God in our church, that we suffer all together. We don't just throw the pastor, so to speak, out to dry. We're not going to stand with him if he's going to stand against homosexual books in our schools in Lancaster County. And we just, well, you go at it, pastor, but we're not going to support you on this. Hopefully you wouldn't do that. And they didn't do that with Peter and John. They stood behind them. They cared for what Peter and John had suffered because they had been jailed, they had been questioned and threatened. And so that was the report from the apostles who came to them. And so in verse 24 it says this, it says, "And when they heard this, they lifted their voices to God with one accord and said, O Lord, it is you who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all that is in them." So when they heard this report, it was though a dark cloud loomed over the people of the church. It was as though Satan was coming against them through the Sanhedrin to attack Peter and John, the early church. And they probably felt ill-equipped to deal with the powers that be. You ever been in a situation at work or wherever, and you want to stand up for your faith, you want to do what you think is right, but the powers that be say, no, this is what we're going to do. This is our policy. Or we want you to follow these instructions. And so you're kind of caught between a rock and a hard place and a bind. And so they felt maybe they were defeated. They were maybe even depressed over what had happened to Peter and John. And so at this point, the church was looked favorably, as I said. They were looked favorably upon by people outside of the church. They liked the apostles. They thought well of the apostles. But the church knew very well how finicky these people would be. You remember Jesus Christ, at the beginning of his last week, we know that he comes riding in on the colt on Palm Sunday, and they cry, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna to the Son of David." But by Friday, what did they say? Crucify him. And so they understood their popularity could change. So right now, the Sanhedrin, would threaten them, but the people thought that Peter and John had healed this lame man, and so they were popular among the people. So the apostles had a good thing going for them there. But they began to pray, it says. It says, they began to pray and they raised or lifted up their voices together in one accord. That means that they were united in their praying. They call on the one in whom there is no variableness or shadow of turning, as James would say. They all recognize the danger posed from this situation. So this was not just some normal nighttime go to bed prayer. No, this was earnest prayer. James says the effectual fervent prayer or the earnest prayer of a righteous man avails much. And so they were praying earnestly. This is almost crying out to God for help. And it says that it was the Lord says that they lifted up their voices, "O Lord, it is you." And that term was used to talk about Jesus in chapter 1. And it means a word that God is the one who has absolute authority. He has absolute power. He is the Lord. You're the master. You're the ruler. You're the one who everything responds to. And so the church is praying. They know what's at stake. They've been threatened by these priests to stop speaking in the name of Jesus. And they arrested them. And we know, what happened to Jesus in the same situation. The Sanhedrin comes and arrests Jesus. And they take him. And he's tried. And he's sentenced to die. So there's a lot at risk. There's a lot at stake. And the same thing could happen to them. The same thing could happen to them. They could be called in and tried and put to death. Who knows? And so this was an important thing. And so it says they know that they've been given a command to obey what Jesus has said. Jesus is the Son of God. They know that. And so they want to obey that command. But they also know what might happen. You ever been in a situation like that? Where you think, well, I think I need to do this, but I'm not sure what will happen if I do this. And so you're not sure what to do. Well, they're in difficult positions. Maybe you've been in that. A time where you were told by someone in authority over you that they expected something of you. A particular thing that they wanted you to do. But then later, you were instructed by someone else that you're supposed to do something opposite of that. Or your faith tells you that you should do something opposite. You shouldn't operate or talk or speak or act in that way. And so maybe you became confused and even upset about this predicament. and you didn't know what to do. Well, the disciples were in that same situation. And they went to the church, they reported what happened, and they called this prayer meeting, and they're praying out to God. So when there's a problem in your life or in the life of the church that threatens the church in a way contrary to the ministry that we're called to carry out, we're called to uphold it, then we must come together and pray. And that's what they did. They said, we've got to call out to God because we don't know what to do. We're being challenged for standing up for what we believe is right and acting on what the Bible teaches. And so they came together in prayer. And as we read, it says, God, you made the heavens and the earth. Lord, you made it all, the sea, the mountains, and everything you made. They acknowledged God as sovereign. That means he reigns over everything, that he controls it all, that it's in his hands, that things of this world doesn't happen outside of God's attention, that he's, for some reason, he's lost control, and there's these evil things that people do, and well, he's just impotent or powerless to do anything about it. That's not God. God never loses his sovereignty. God never loses control. He is the only God. They acknowledge that. He's God mightier than the Sanhedrin and all of Jesus' enemies combined. He's the God, and there is no other God. As I read from Psalm 96 this morning, these other gods are small g gods. But he's the powerful God that holds all creation in his hands. He has total control. And he knows everything about situations. He knows the things that we don't know about situations. You ever thought of that? Sometimes you have limited knowledge about issues and why things may have happened or what's going on in a circumstance. But God, he's omniscient. That means he knows everything. And sometimes we have to sit back and say, okay, God, I don't understand why you're doing this, but you're God, and you are in control, and I acknowledge that you know more than I know. That's what Job did. Job says, oh, I spoke out of turn, God. You know everything. You know what you're talking about. Job didn't know what God knew, and neither do we. We don't know what God knows, and so we have to acknowledge God and let him do what he does. And understand that God has his own reasons for allowing things to happen. But that doesn't mean that we've got the right to know why God does the things that he does. We don't know. And things happen that years down the road could explain why the things happen today in regard to what happens in the future. We don't know. So, verse 25, we see that they prayed to God who was the creator, but they also prayed to God who inspired scriptures. In verse 25, look at that verse with me. It says, who by the Holy Spirit, through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said this. He said, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples devise futile things? So David prophesied beforehand this opposition, and Peter quotes that here. And David lived 1,000 years before this was ever written. And he says, why do these Gentiles rage? That means the nations. Why do they rage against God? Or they devise or imagine some sort of a futile or a vain thing that they would come and try to stand against God. It's futile. It's vainless. There's no reason to do it. But David's writing saying, why do the heathen do this? The King James Version says the heathen. It's talking about the pagans, the people that don't believe in God. They don't want to acknowledge God. Why do they do that, David says? They devise a vain thing. It's a futile thing to try to stand against God. And so why do they do that? They plot how they can rebel against God. And they reject God. They turn against God. Verse 26, it says, the kings of the earth, they took their stand. And the rulers who were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. And so we see that in the day of David, other kings, they would come to battle against the children of Israel, but they always would pray to God and acknowledge God, that God would win the battle for them. The battle belonged to God, right? That God would defeat the enemies of the Israelites. And today we see kings of the earth and those who are coming against, they gather together as though they're going to outlaw God and you know, say God is dead, he's gone, there's no reason to worship a God anymore. And and their presidents and congressmen and governors and other state and local leaders who are today taking their stand against God. They may not outwardly come out and say things like this, but behind the scenes, they're not acknowledging God and His Word and His principles, the Christian principles and values that our country was founded on. And there's an agenda. There's a spin behind the things that they're doing. They're taking their stand against God. They don't accept the teachings of the Bible. And they fight against what it says in order to push a worldly or a man's agenda, because they think they know more than God. They think, well, this is the way it ought to be. And so they want their agenda to be accomplished. They don't stand up for what God says. Well, those world leaders come together, as I said, and they try to defeat God. And you know, folks, that's what's going to happen in the tribulation. You know, when we get raptured out of here and the tribulation comes, all of the kings of the earth, they're going to come together and form a coalition. And they will turn against God. And they'll worship this false prophet, the Antichrist. And they'll want to bow down to Satan, the devil. That's what's going to happen. They're going to take their stand against God. But Jesus is coming back the second time. And He's going to defeat all of His enemies. And they're going to become a footstool. And He's going to become the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There are many people throughout history who have tried to stand against God. There have been antichrist and who have come before. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 26 says this about Jesus. It says, "For He must reign until He has put all enemies under His feet." And Jesus will come back. He's going to reign, and He's going to defeat every enemy that He has. And so David says, the kings of the earth took their stand, and the rulers and the were gathered together, and they were against the Lord, and against who? His Christ? I thought Christ comes in the New Testament. This is Peter quoting Psalm 2. This was written 200 years ago. They come against the Lord and against His Christ. Now this is the Holy Spirit prophesying through David to write this. He says there's a Messiah coming. You see, David had been given the promise that he would have seed or a descendant of his that would come from his body who would rule and reign forever. Just as David was a king, God promised him that you're going to have a descendant after me who will rule and reign forever. And that's Jesus Christ. And He's inspired when He writes this. The kings of the earth take their stand against the Lord and against His Christ, the Messiah. They're against God. They're against the anointed. And so it is that it's though as that God is obligated by His word. He knew that David had prophesied this. It's as though God is obligated to deal with this crisis, because it was God who had inspired David to write this. And so now they call this up and say, "Okay, God, we need your help." Even David said it was going to come, that they were going to stand against you, and they were going to stand against your Christ. And that's exactly what happened. Verse 27 says in Jerusalem, the leaders, Pilate and Herod, we know the story, the kings and the leaders, they gathered against Jesus Christ. And they took Him, arrested Him, God furnished everything that Jesus needed. As you see, it says, "God, you're anointed both Herod and Pontius Pilate, all along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your purpose predestined to occur." As I said, God wasn't taken aback by this happening. No, God predestined what happened to Jesus. Jesus was anointed. God knew everything that was going to happen. And so they tried to kill Him, but then they wouldn't accept anything less than a sentence for death for Jesus. And so that's why it happened, but God allowed it. And Jesus knew that it was going to happen. And so God was working all of this out according to His plan. And He's going to cause all those things to work together and come to pass just like He wanted. And so you see, people who stand against God and Jesus, they're all under God's control, all under His purposes. You see, they're pawns in His hand. He knows what's going to happen. And He can make things happen the way that He wants.
So know this, God is always in control. As I said, nothing escapes his attention.
He causes all things to work together for good, right? Romans 8, 28.
He causes it all to work together for good, to those who are called according to his purposes.
So the people who stood against Jesus and had him crucified didn't do anything that God hadn't already planned. And for us today, whatever happens today is the same way. That we might think is an ungodly attack, but maybe God is using this in some way. He knows all about it. And God wants us to stand up for his word. He wants us to stand up for his glory. And we have to do our part to be salt and light. We have to stand up for what's true. And we want to lead people to the truth. We don't want our world to go to hell and just to get worse and worse and worse. No, we believe that blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. That's why we stand on the word of God. We'll be blessed if we do what God says, but if we turn from what God says, we're going to suffer. That's why we stand on the Bible. And that's why we vote that way. That's why we vote against same-sex marriage. That's why we vote against abortion. We stand against those things because that's not God. And you and I live in this world, and if our world suffers, then we're going to suffer. So we want to obey God. That's why we stand on these things. We have to seek the truth and to live according to the truth, or we're going to reap the consequences of going against God. You reap what you sow. That's the scripture said. So there's a cause for sin. And the sin of this world affects believers, as I said, because we are living in this world. And God's will is going to happen. As I said, nothing escapes God's word. Well, verse 29, they were praying and they said, "Now, Lord, consider their threats. Enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness." It says, "Now, Lord, because of all of this, God, because of what you said, because of the prophecy of David and this threatening against us, we want you to take notice. Take notice of what they're doing to us as your people. They're threatening us. They're telling us to stop talking about Jesus and preaching in his name." And they were praying to God. They were seeking God for his help. And so, yes, God does see when his people are being threatened. Now, Lord, we have to look to him. We have to pray. And that's what they did. They were praying to God. Now, that doesn't mean that just because we pray and we believe God, that everything's going to work out like we want it to. It may not. It may not. But it does mean that God knows when his people are being threatened and challenged for standing up for their beliefs. So know that if you're suffering or you're standing up for something and you're being threatened possibly or being opposed, know that God is with you. God never leaves you. He doesn't forsake you. He's there and he's watching as you submit to his will, as you do what your faith convicts you is right. God is with you. So they pray, "Okay, God, you take notice of what's happened. You see our circumstance." That's what we do. We call out to God and say, "God, this is what's happening, and I know you know about it." That's what they did. They looked to God. And then secondly, verse 29 says, "Enable us, grant us, help us. You make it happen, God. We can only do this through your strength, and it's your power that we need. We're asking for your help, Lord." They didn't want to shrink in fear of man. They wanted to stand up because they were called by God. And they were saying, "God, we need boldness. We need courage." They wanted to continue to speak God's word of grace and mercy and salvation and eternal life. But they were being threatened. And so they said, "God, we need your help. We need your spirit. Would you enable us to be able to do this?" The circumstances were, the stakes were high. And so they wanted to call out to God earnestly. And what did they pray for? Well, they didn't call out for vengeance. "It's okay, God, won't you just come down and strike these people and kill them all? Just get rid of the Sanhedrin." You know, they could have done that. Kind of reminds me of Peter. This Peter that we're hearing preach this sermon cut the ear off of Malchus in the Garden of Eden when they came to arrest Jesus. So he pulled out his sword and he took